I would like to start with thanking Andreas and Lai for letting me opportunity to speak here. It's really great idea, great initiative, really nice, really great. So I'm going to talk about speed of front propagation for stochastic reaction diffusion equations, and this is a joint work with Karl Müller and Leonie Ryzhik. Okay, we'll start from some deterministic equation, and the one which is of particular interest to us, the so-called deterministic KPP or FKPP equation, which goes after name Fisher, Kolmogorov, Petrovsky, Piskunov, who studied it independently, started studying independently in '30s. And the equation looks like this. It's equation for a function depending on time and space in one dimension. And derivative in time is Laplacian in space. So this is kind of heat equation. And there is a drift here, U1 minus U. And we talk about, we'll be talking about solutions which are between 0 and 1. By the way, one remark here that in fact, I was told that this equation was introduced even earlier than Fisher and Kolmogorov, Petrovsky, Piskunov by Luther in 1906 to study propagation of chemical reactions in space. Few words about motivation for such equation. We talk about population which is situated in, on R, and UTX will be a proportion, one can think of proportion of population time X with an advantageous gene. And members population move in random, and for this, and this gives rise to this term Laplacian, which kind of corresponds to a symmetric random walk in a continuous setting. But there is some interaction also. More fit members replace less fit, and frequency of interaction is proportional to U1 minus U, and this gives rise to this term, so which kind of brings up the proportion of more fit individuals U. This is motivation, and a few words about solution. There is a particular class of solution which people are interested a lot in the deterministic KPP equation, the so-called traveling wave solution. This is solution which travels kind of to the trade-offs to the right with speed c. And if you look at the solution around the point ct, you see the same pattern. So that's kind of that's why it's called traveling wave solution. And this wave solves this equation where c is this constant which says with which speed the solution goes to the right. And we also will be in the setting that solution goes from 1 to 0. So at plus infinity at 0, at minus infinity at 1. One thing mention, the picture is a bit misleading since it looks like it's 0 here and 1 here, but it's positive. Since this heat equation, this Laplacian term, make sure that you never hit 0 here and you never hit 1 here. So it's always, looks like this. Okay, this is deterministic. We can also talk about other solutions. And for this, we'll introduce a set of initial conditions, which we call initial conditions with compact interface, or sometimes I take a bit misleading compact support. And the idea is that this is one. And you start here, so you have some. So this will be initial condition such that there is last point where the initial condition is greater equal to 0, and there is also the left edge of interface, or usually I say it's support. Yeah. So we talk about this kind of initial conditions in our talk. And this set is initial conditions denoted by CI. It turns out if you start with this, with such initial conditions, then there is this MT such that if you look at your, such that MT over T goes to C star, such that if you look at your equation around MT point in space at time T, and T goes to infinity, this equation converges to traveling wave solution with speed C star, and this C star, which is square root of 2, is the minimal speed which is possible for non-negative solution of this equation. Okay, so this, so you can, when you start with this type of initial condition, the message is you converge to traveling wave solution with the minimal speed C star. And so we know that MT from this formula is like T times C star. And then Bramson found that there is a logarithmic correction here with the specific constant in front of log. And there is also some constant here, another constant, which depends on the initial condition U0. Sometimes it's called Bramson shift. One can talk about more general non-linearities here, more general drift. Fu, which satisfies some condition, it's Lipschitz at zero and at one, and some derivative condition at zero. And then the minimal speed will be, in general, will be defined like this. It's square root of 2 times the derivative of f, which is exactly square root of 2 in this case. Okay, so we can also talk about more general drifts here for KPP equations. And now the question is, now the idea is to move to stochastic KPP equation. So this was deterministic one, and now we introduce some noise to the equation, put some noise here. And noise is multiplicative noise. So this is this part, W dot Tx, which is Gaussian space-time white noise with covariance function, which is delta in space, in time, and delta in space, which essentially means that this noise has independent values at different space-time points. And this is Gaussian. And this noise is here is multiplicated by the square root of u1 minus u, and some parameter sigma, which gives information about the size, how big is the noise. Okay, informally you can think about variance of this noise around so in the area dt dx to be utx, it's the square of this parameter. Okay, is there a sigma? There is sigma square here. Ut one minus u dx dt. This is the variance, how much noise is in a small area. Motivation. We can again think about biological motivation. Just outcome of interaction between fit and unfit individuals may be random. So sometimes unfit may also win, and this gives rise to noise. So randomness. Interaction between fit and fit are independent at different space-time points. That's why the noise is white in space and time. And the rate of interaction is proportional again to the number of individuals of both fit and fit times at every point. That's why variance is proportional to u1 minus u. Okay, and variance of this is, as I see, this one. This is the motivation behind this choice of the noise. And so we're going to study this equation of this type, sometimes with more general function here. And again, we'll talk about the same class of initial conditions with comport support or comport interface, depending on how you want to call it. And there are a number of questions you may ask. Is compact support property preserved in time? which means if you start with a complex support, whether so when time goes on, whether you still will be in position that here you have some LT, here you have some RT, and the complex support property preserved. So the question is whether this is true, whether this is the picture, which is definitely not the picture in the case without noise. When you don't have noise, I told you this term says that you, so RT is infinity and LT is minus infinity. You have a solution is always between zero and one. If a compact support property is preserved, does there exist the speed of propagation, for example, of right edge of the support, which means there is a limit of RT over T, which will be V sigma, depending on this parameter sigma. And if this is the case, what how this speed of propagation of the right edge of the support depends on sigma. This type of questions that we would like to address in this talk. And another motivation why we may be interested in studying KPP equations, stochastic KPP equation. One of the motivation is that there is very nice duality of this equation with branching Brownian motions and another related model of branching Brownian motion. So what branching Brownian motion? It's a system of particles moving as independent Brownian motion, and each particle splits into a trait one independently of the others. Yeah? So you have particle, there is exponential time of rate one. After this time, particle splits, and the resulting particle again moves independent Brownian motions. And for simplicity, we start from one particle time zero in the spatial point zero. And RBT will be the position of rightmost particle at time t for such system. And how it's related to our KPP equation? Let u solve the KPP equation, again, the regular one, and the initial condition will be the step function. Yeah, which is the case. So when R zero and L zero, they are the same. So you start with the same. You start with the step function at step function at zero. Yeah. And the speed of propagation of u, I call it V zero, is square root of two. And we've seen this already. And turns out that there is very nice duality relation. If I ask the probability that rightmost particle, the branching Brownian motion, maybe it's a good idea just to again to write what is branching Brownian motion. So you have this picture, this is time. So you start the branching Brownian motion somewhere, suppose this is zero. It goes, then it splits, it goes, then it splits, it goes this way. And so this will be RBT. Oops. RBT. Okay. And it turns out that the speed of propagation of this rightmost particle in branching Brownian motion is the same as the speed of propagation of this KPP equation. Okay, it's the same square root of two, and this follows from this McKean duality relationship, which allows you to calculate the probability that RBT is greater than Z in terms of UTZ, which is the solution to this equation. Yeah, you ask, what's where RBT is greater than Z? This will be, you take this equation at time T at point Z, and this will give the probability. And this immediately gives that the speed of propagation of this, not immediately, but very fast, give the speed of propagation of this is exactly the speed of propagation of. Okay. Questions? No. Okay. What about stochastic KPP equation. How is this related to our story? You take the same system, particle, branch and Brownian motion, particle splits, but on top of this, every pair of particle coalesces at rate sigma square in proportional to the intersection local times. So the so the particles all move like independent Brownian motion. There is local time between each pair, and so when local time exceeds certain unit, so with rate sigma square, they coalesce, and then one particle is left. So this system is definitely smaller than the system we had before, since some particle disappear. Okay, and again we state that have the same branching coalescence system starting one particle at time zero, and RBC with position of the rightmost particle at time t. And it turns out that there is also duality relation here, like before. Before we found, so if I want write most particle here, again maybe I'll just a picture. So now we have less particles, so they go this way, go this way. Now this way, this way. Oops. No. Okay. So they go this way, this way, this way. And then so this particle, they spend some time to go, and then they coalesce and there's left one particle. And so this again goes this way, and you take here the RBC. Okay. And turns out, so before it was just solution to the here, when I wanted to find this probability for branching Brownian motion, this was solution to KPP equation. Now it will be solution to stochastic KPP equation. And you will need to take the expectation since it's random. So in the end, you'll need to take the expectation. And the Shiga proved that this probability can be calculated this way, which means if you know the speed of propagation of this equation, you can get some bounds on the speed of propagation of this rightmost particle in this coalescent branching system, which is much more difficult to analyze since there is interaction between particles. It's an interacting particle system, yeah, since these particles interact with each other. So this gives you maybe another motivation to study stochastic KPP equations. Okay, so we have several questions I asked in the beginning. So this is the equation we're going to study. And Karl Müller and Towers, so they proved that compact support property holds for any time there are finite LT and RT such that the interface is finite. Okay. They also show that for small sigma, there is a rate of there is finite rate of propagation of rightmost the right edge of the support, and we call it V sigma. And moreover, they prove that for small sigma, there is a stationary limit. If I look at the process starting at the left edge of the support, yeah, how it behaves. There, yeah, so we look somehow at the process. So if this is LT, so we look how the process looks when we're looking from this point. And they show that there is a stationary limit to this process. Okay. Other values of sigma, since this here I said the result is for small noise. The noise is small. Colin Dering in 2005 showed that in fact for any sigma there is a limit of a limiting speed of propagation of the rightmost of the right edge of the support. Yeah, you ask, take this point which is here. And so this is RT, and you ask what is the speed of propagation at this point. And they showed that it exists. They didn't find the value, but they exist. The next question is dependence of V, of rate of propagation, of the right edge of the support, how it depends on sigma itself, on how big is the noise. We know one value, yeah? We know that if sigma is zero, it should be square root of, it should be square root of two. There is no RT, basically, since it's not a compact support, but we know that the all the picture moves to the right with speed square root of two.
Leonid, just one question from the chat. What's the fluctuation of RT?
Okay. For this model, I guess we don't know. This is okay. We basically, I guess, most of the thing we know is it is some information about the speed, but I even didn't come to this point yet. But we don't know about fluctuation around that value. At least I don't.
All right.
Okay. Okay. Now, so how V depends on sigma. For small sigma, so we know that somehow speed should approach square root of two. And Colin Durant showed that so small sigma, V of sigma is less than square root of two, which is not surprising, since if we think about dual picture, which is branching coalescent system, the less particle, which means the speed of propagation should be less. And similar, so if you think about the noise, you can always think about noise that it somehow slows down the propagation. Since this noise term, in fact, corresponds to coalescence in the dual picture, according to duality. So the noise always slows down. So this is not very surprising. But it was surprising that they found some lower bound also on this speed. And so if we ignore, for example, this log-log term, it's the noise has very, very big effect. So it's like one over log sigma square up to log sigma square up to some constant. Okay. Then in a joint paper with Carl and Jeremy, so we showed that in fact precise asymptotic for V sigma when sigma is small, we find all this constant, no log here, and you say that again the correction to the speed without noise will be pi square over two log sigma square square. Okay, and this was the conjecture, in fact, lower. So it was earlier conjecture of Brunet and Derrida. And this type of correction also appears in number of papers, which are listed here, Berat, Berestikis, and Jason. Okay. Large sigma. Now, this is all for small sigma, which we know, in fact, everything. Not everything. We know that for sigma goes to zero, it should go to square root of two. The question is, what happens if noise is getting larger and larger, for sigma large? And Colin Durin also got some kind of information. They showed that, in fact, the lymph inf of sigma square V sigma is greater or equal than one, and conjectured, and in fact, this is the right result, that sigma square V sigma goes to one, which means for large sigma, the rate of propagation, again, of RT, is one over sigma square. Okay, and in this work we'll verify this conjecture that is the correct one. By the way, few more words about the general stochastic KPP equation. So not necessarily U times one minus U term. F is a KPP time if F is Lipschitz, F zero F one is zero. And there is some condition on the derivative at zero in relation to function f. Okay, without loss of generality, we assume that derivative function f at zero is one. Just to just to make it easier for presentation. And it was shown that, in fact, the correction in the same paper, we showed, in fact, the correction to the speed for small noise doesn't depend, in fact, on the shape of function f. It's the same pi up to this order. It's still pi square two log sigma square square. Okay, there may be something here, but this doesn't depend on the shape of the function as long as we know its derivative here. And the idea just the idea that one should keep in mind. So how the proof of such result might work. Whenever the noise is small, we try to compare this equation with some deterministic equation. And it turns out that when, so at the points where the value of the function u is small, so it's on the right, solution is always is going to zero to the right. So whether u is small, and in particular less than sigma square, in some sense noise wins, which means noise eliminates the effect of the drift. And that's why one can compare this equation with solution to this deterministic equation when this nonlinear, reaction term, this nonlinear drift, so it acts only for u greater or equal than sigma square. When u is less sigma square, it doesn't affect equation. So it's called the equation with cutoff. It turns out that the speed of propagation to the right of this equation, so up to this order, is exactly this one, which means that this equation for small sigma behaves very similarly to this deterministic equation in terms of propagation to the right. What's the speed with which it goes to the right? Okay, since the correction here will be the same. Okay. And the question was, in fact, another question is, can we in fact take more general f? So as I said here, we insist that f is a Lipschitz function, and here zero, f1, zero, derivative here at zero. And in fact, the derivative describes this, so when sigma is small, it describes, when sigma is zero, it describes the speed of propagation of deterministic equation. So, and, turns out that we can also study, we can give up on the Lipschitz condition on this drift. And this is our first theorem, Carr and Lönje. We say that fu is bounded from above by this function, u1 minus u to 1/2. So loosely speaking, at zero, so you have a function which is Hölder with exponent greater or equal than 1/2, and similarly at one. So it may be far away from Lipschitz. And, this is the case. And the first thing, so first result, there is a unique and low solution to this equation. And still we have compact support property. The fact that this is Hölder doesn't ruin out the fact that compact interface is preserved. And the solution has a speed, a finite speed V sigma. And this is, in fact, a bit surprising for people who know deterministic equations. Is that if there is no drift, no noise, then the speed with which the deterministic one is propagate is, as we saw, square root of 2 f prime 0. This is the speed of deterministic one. Okay, here, if you take the Hölder function, the derivative will be infinity. So the speed will be infinity. Indeed, the speed of the solution to the deterministic KPP, whenever you have a function which is not Lipschitz and Hölder at zero, then the speed of propagation will be infinity. It turns out that the noise has, in fact, indeed a dramatic effect here that it brings you down to the finite speed of propagation of the equation to the right. Proof. Okay, so we need to prove a few things. So there is unique and low solution, and RTRT are finite. Okay. And this is one of the main issues in the paper. We try to since we don't care now how it depends on sigma, we can just take sigma equals to one for the sake of the proof of theorem one. So we have this equation which we'd like to analyze, and we'll compare it with this equation without the drift. And it turns out that about this equation, we know a lot. It was shown one time ago that this equation has unique and law solution. So the question is, when you have equation with drift and without drift, and for this you know uniqueness, you try to use the Gersano theorem, and in this setting is called Dolson-Gersano theorem. But you try to show that for any solution to this equation, its law is absolutely continuous to the law of this equation with Gersanov derivative e to zt, and the Gersanov exponential is given by this formula. Yeah, you just take, it's the usual way of writing Gersanov exponent. You take the drift divided by this one, and this is the quadratic variation. Okay, you need to have this, and you need to have that this quadratic variation in the exponent is finite for any solution to this equation under this measure p mu, not under this one. Under this one we know, under this one. If you have this, then you get the weak uniqueness. So we show both of these two results. In fact, you may somehow say that from weak uniqueness and from this proof that the solution to the law of this equation is absolutely continuous with respect to law of this equation, you can get the new, that V has compact support property. Yeah, since this one has compact support property. This we know also. And again, compact support, which means so LT and RT are finite. Okay, so and if they're absolutely continuous, then also this has compact support property. Okay, but it's not, unfortunately it's cheating, since in order to show this result, we in fact need to show independently that V has compact support property. So proving that any solution to this equation has compact support property like this is an independent result you don't get from weak uniqueness. Since for weak uniqueness you need it. And this, so this independent argument to show that this holds almost surely and compact support property holds almost surely. Okay. Okay, so we got this and existence of the speed one can show by subadditive ergodic theorem, which is in the way similar it was done in Conlon-Doering. Okay, so we know that there is solution for F, not necessarily Lipschitz, but maybe Hölder. And again, this is the equation which we'll use a lot to, describe things. To prove things. Important thing, so Carl Müller and Roger Tribe in 97 showed that again the distribution of this equation, when you look at this from the left hand, left edge of the support, converges to unique stationary distribution. Okay, and we'll define this will be the sign for expectation under this stationary law of W, of this one. No drift, no this thing. So all our work is to see how this drift and how this sigma, how they influence the speed of propagation. And now the result is follows. We again ask from our drift to be bounded by Hölder function, U1 minus U2 gamma. Where gamma now it should be strictly greater than 1/2. Again, let initial conditions will be here. Then the speed of propagation will be exactly what we want. V sigma behaves like some constant divided by sigma square. So this limit exists. This is this, and this constant, which is here, is defined as an expectation of this function f over stationary solution to this equation. Okay, this is the stationary law. So if we have explicit, we have expression that defines this this constant. Now you may ask how it's related to Dorin-Conlon conjecture. Yeah? Since Dorin-Conlon, they said that, what did they say? They say that f, if f of u is u1 minus u, then c of f is 1. Okay, this is what Dorin-Conlon. Okay, that's what they say. This means that we, for the function f, which looks like this, we need to show that this expectation is one. Then we verify the conjecture of Conlon-Dorin. Here we say that we can do it for any function. There is some constant nobody knows how to calculate. They insist that cf is one for this function. And it turns out that from the results of Roger Tribe in 95, we can define that indeed the expected value of this expression on the stationary measure is one. And so CF indeed is one when FU is U1 minus U. So you get this result and you verify this this conjecture. So this kind of this theorem, which is more general than theorem of Dorin-Conlon, but as a particular case, you get this conjecture for the case when f of u is u times 1 minus u. Okay. I'll make a few remarks on theorem 2. I don't think I have time for the proof, but I just like to say why one can believe that V sigma behaves like constant over sigma square. And in fact, in this case, one over sigma square. Okay. So we take the particular case u one minus u. Don't do it for the general. I don't give heuristics for the general case, but for this simple one. Okay. This is our equation. Okay. And sigma is large, goes to infinity. This term with the noise, if you integrate according to with respect to time, with respect to space, get this one, and this is a martingale. So this term is a martingale. Okay. And one can show that in fact, the left edge of the support and right edge of the support, they behave like this martingale, this integral, and integral of this also respect to space and time. In fact, it's kind of a general, okay, there is also correction here, but of order less than t. In fact, this is a kind of general understanding in the PTE literature dealing with KPP, that if you want to see the speed of propagation to the right of solution to KPP equation, you need to take all these reaction terms, integrate it with respect to time, respect to say, space, divide by t, send t to infinity, and the limit will, if you can identify it, will give you the speed of propagation. Okay? So and in this setting, so what we can show in fact rigorously show that the right and left hand side they behave right and left edges of the support behave like this, exactly what one need to show this. Okay, pay attention that what is written here which is the integral of this one, is 1 over sigma square of the quadratic variation of this martingale. Yes, it's quadratic variation of this martingale. How it's calculated? You take square of the integral dx ds. Square of the integral we see square, sigma square times this. So what's written here is just 1 over sigma square of quadratic variation. So this is first part of the argument. The second part, it's was shown again by Tribe that this martingale, as sigma goes to infinity, converges to Brownian motion. This is very important ingredient. So you know that as time goes to infinity, as sigma goes to infinity, this martingale, which doesn't look at Brownian motion, converges to Brownian motion. But if this is true, then for large sigma, these processes looks like 1 sigma square, again, like this, 1 over sigma square quadratic variation of martingale plus martingale. Martingale is approximately Brownian motion. Quadratic variation is t over sigma square. So if you want the speed, you divide by t, and 1 over sigma square is the speed. This is the heuristics why the result should be true. Okay, so again, this martingale, whatever is here, behaves like Brownian motion. This quadratic variation of this also converges to quadratic variation of Brownian motion, and this allows to identify the speed. Why I'm teaching, cheating a little bit, so I somehow interchange the order of limits. Just want to know that the speed behaves like 1 over sigma square, which means in principle we need first to send t to infinity, identify the speed, and make sure that the speed is 1 over sigma square. What we do here, we do it the other way around. We somehow first send sigma to infinity and show that the resulting process looks like Brownian motion with this drift, and this gives me the speed. So this is taken care rigorously in the proof how to indeed do the interchanging of the limits. Okay, so this kind of heuristics about the theorem. Few remarks, few more remarks. There is huge difference between the case when this noise is small and when this noise is large, when sigma is large and sigma is big. Okay. So let's consider this equation. So suppose sigma is small. When sigma is small, and I said it already, you can think about this equation as a reaction diffusion equation perturbed by a small noise. So everything that happens here should be somehow be predicted from deterministic case. And this is again, and this is indeed the case, since as we said, so when u is small, so noise wins the competition against this this drift, and we can replace, show that behavior of this equation looks like behavior of this deterministic equation whose speed, asymptotic of the speed we know. So again, the main message is this is the deterministic equation perturbed by small noise. Okay. What happens with large sigma? Okay, this is the equation. And it may be tempting to try to say, okay, this is the deterministic equation perturbed by large noise. But if you do rescaling, time and space rescaling, and get this equation, you can easily see that this equation, if I don't get into details, solves a very similar equation, if you do rescaling of this one. Just the, you get the noise of normal size at the expense that you get very small reaction diffusion term. Yeah? You have this, here sigma is large, you do rescaling, and transform sigma from here to here with power to sigma minus 4. Okay? Sigma is huge, drift is very small. Noise is of normal size. And one can easily again check that to show that the speed of this one is of order sigma to minus two is the same to say the speed of this one is of order sigma minus four. So we can just analyze this equation, V. And the main difference is that now this is not a deterministic equation perturbed by noise, it's a stochastic equation perturbed by small drift. Okay? And to prove the convergence, in fact, what we're doing, we compare, and this is what I have shown you in the heuristic, we compare this equation, stochastic equation with small drift, with the stochastic equation without drift, and for comparing, we use the Gersonov formula. This is the main difference here. So we, in fact, use information about this stochastic equation. And another remark that noise, again, I look at this equation, so suppose with large noise, noise makes huge difference. You can adjust, here I say, okay, to get right information, you need to compare it with this one. Maybe somebody could say, okay, maybe I just drop out this noise. And I'll stay with this KPP, which is linear one. And you take classical case, V times one minus V. Then you have this deterministic equation, and we know the speed of propagation of this equation. It's constant over sigma squared. But we prove that the speed of propagation of this one is one over sigma to the fourth. What does it mean? The equation without noise propagates with huge speed compared to the speed of the stochastic equation. Okay? This is much, much bigger than this one. Okay, which means that noise indeed makes huge difference here. Another remark, if you take FV, not this classical case, but the Yolder case, as I said before, the speed of propagation of the deterministic equation is infinite, but the speed of propagation of stochastic one is finite. So noise somehow drops down the speed of propagation from infinity to finite value. And also, this is just nice, you can also find the example of function f and sigma such that the deterministic equation will propagate with positive speed to the right, and the stochastic equation will propagate with negative speed to the left. So in fact, you can, and the noise may change direction of the propagation of the equation, which is not very surprising after you see that, in fact, your noise is so strong that it can drop down the speed of propagation from infinity to a finite number. And I guess,
Excuse me, Leonid, I see that you still have seven slides. Can you
wrap up? No, I just got one.
Okay.
Seven slides, it's just a precaution for the case you'll ask me for more. No, just one. Open problems. It's surprisingly, we don't know that, if you take this equation, we don't know that the speed of propagation of the rightmost point is the same as the speed of propagation of the leftmost point. We don't know this, even this simple fact. This is what is known for some function f and for some sigma from Carl Müller and Sauers. They proved this, but in general, we don't know this. We don't know what happens if the Yolder coefficient is less than 1/2. So it says, okay, greater than 1/2, we can say something, but less than 1/2, we don't know anything. What happens with the small noise asymptotic when this function f is Yolder? I said, when this is Lipschitz and of KPP class, this was shown in paper with Carl and Jeremy. This is near square root of 2, but what happens is f is of the class that we considered here, like u1 minus u to power gamma, where gamma is less than 1. And the question is open, and this is an ongoing project with postdocs at the Technion, Clayton Barnes and Jean-Yao San. And I guess I'll stop here. Thank you very much for your attention.
Pascal, you're muted.
Now I'm muted. Oh.
Okay, live, I'd like to unmute everybody. Big clap. All right, so thanks, Leonid, for this wonderful talk. Do you have questions, guys? So maybe I can ask a question. So can you say something about multidimensional generalizations? And maybe also if you take other noise terms, what happens?
He's
muted, I see. Okay, Leonid, do you hear me?
Yeah, I hear you. If you can hear me, it's also good. Okay. Yes. I guess we know very little about all this stuff. Multidimensional generalization would be extremely interesting. The trouble is one need to know how to define all these terms, since if it's white noise and the dimensions higher than one, these terms are not very well defined. We know very little about what's going on there. Presumably, if a noise is large and you somehow generalize it to the high dimension, which in fact nobody tried to do, but you can try to do it on the lattice, for example, you can get something. But I don't know anything. Anybody has done anything. You can probably get similar results, but the point is you need to start with the getting some information about these equations of this without drift. Whereas where are these equations? These ones. Yeah. So the. For large noise, you need first of all to start with something like this and to generalize it to the high dimension and to see what's going with the boundary of this equation in high dimensions, which will be interesting. I don't know, in fact, what's going on there. Yeah.
All right, thanks. So there is a question coming in, which is probably related to what you just said. Is there an analog and discrete case to your large noise results?
Not that I know. Not about the in not about no 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 not that I know. I guess it's the whatever we found, it's this open problem in during Conlon, and that's so. But I don't know any. I didn't find anything about this. But in discrete case, it should be similar in one dimension. What happens in dimension more than one? One first need to define the boundary there and to see how it propagates. Yeah, but it's a very interesting question. Very interesting question.
All right, and. Okay, maybe two last questions. The first one, you mentioned this duality with branch of many motion. Is there a similar duality for bistable nonlinearities?
Again, I'm not sure, since this nonlinearities, for different branching mechanism of branching Brownian motion, you have different functional. For this binary branching, we have u times 1 minus u. For different branching mechanism, you may have different functions, but it's a specific class of function. Not that you can take any function and say, okay, this now will be a duality with some branching mechanism. And by the way, I forgot to say this. So the question of f being Hölder in fact gives some FB in Gölder, it's not purely academic. You can think about branching Brownian motion with coalescence, where branching is where you have number of offspring with which is in the domain of attraction of some without first moment. Okay, number of kids of each particle is without first moment. Then you'll have here functions which are in fact Gölder. And this gives you, in fact, some idea how such system may propagate the branching coalescing process whenever your number of kids doesn't have first moment. Okay, if you ask back to the question, duality, as I know, is something that corresponds to this. Generating function of the distribution of number of offspring. Then you have duality.
Okay, thank you. So there is one last question, but maybe we take it to the breakout room. Life, can you explain us how it works?